And what we've seen so far is that R stands for?
Regeneration.
I stands for?
Indwelling.
And today we want to deal with B, which stands for?
Baptism.
So good morning, everyone, NCB and friends. We want to resume our study today of what we believe, and what we believe is the baptism of the Holy Spirit at the moment of salvation. The Holy Spirit gives us ribs. R, as we've already said, stands for regeneration. We are born again. Only people who have been born again go to God's heaven, because that's the home of His family. So you must be born again. Of course, the most famous conversation is John chapter 3. Jesus is talking to a religious individual named Nicodemus. All religious people go to hell. Only people who are believers and have been born again go to heaven, because you have to be a member of God's family, and you can't join it. You can't sneak in. You can't back your way in. And everybody that's going to heaven knows they're going to heaven, because everybody that's going to leave this church today is not going to walk out to the parking lot, get in their car, and say, where do I live? No, you know exactly where you live. And when you're at the mall at night and it's dark, you're not scratching your head saying, I wonder where I live. Where's my home? No, you know exactly where your home is. Everybody that's going to heaven knows they're going to heaven. And if you don't know that you're going to heaven, then you need to trust Christ as your Savior so you can know. Because God gives us in His Word truth that says we can know. And 1 John 5:13, these things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you might
know
that you have eternal life, that you might continue to believe on the name of the Son of God. So I'm not guessing, I'm not hoping, I'm not going to find out when I die. I know right now that I'm going to heaven. Not because of anything I've done, not because I'm the pastor of the church, not because I've been a Christian 41 years, not because of anything. It's simply because 41 years ago, I trusted Jesus as my Savior. And Jesus says in John 10:27-30, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, they follow me, and I give unto them
eternal
life, and they shall never perish. My Father who gave them to me is greater than all. I and my Father are one. So we can know. It's not arrogance. It's confidence in what God has said. It's trust in what God has said. It's belief in what God has said. And so we have confidence, and we can live with boldness because God has made us specific promises. So those of us who have been born again, we get to go to heaven because we're part of the family of God. I stands for indwelling. The Holy Spirit indwells us. At the same moment He regenerates us, He comes in and takes up His residence in us. And we saw in John 14 that the Holy Spirit is with us how long? Forever. Which is again implies that once you are born again and once you are indwelt by the Spirit of God, you can never be unborn and unindwelt, which means that you are eternally secure. All right? And I don't know why people fuss and foom over that and miss that and think that they can, you know, some people actually think that they're stronger than God and they can break away from God. It's foolishness. Nobody can snatch you out of His hand, and that nobody includes you. You can't take yourself away from God. Once God's got a hold of you, do you really believe you can get away from Him? I don't think so. And you know what? I'm thankful that I can't. Because, of course, if it was dependent on us holding on to God, we'd slip away real fast. But God's holding us. And thank the Lord for that. So we're indwelt. The Holy Spirit takes up residence in each and every believer. And then B, where we are today, in our acronym of RIBS, stands for baptism. And baptism is what takes place when we believe. So today we want to discuss the baptism of the Holy Spirit and just have a brief word of prayer. Father, thank you for the truth of the Holy Spirit taught in the Word of God, that He is Comforter, that He regenerates and dwells, and now we're looking at the fact that We're baptized with the Spirit. I pray your blessings on the message and each one that's here today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, the definitive passage that we want to look at, and you can turn there, is 1 Corinthians 12:13. There are 11 or 12 passages deal with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And there's quite a bit of confusion about it, but that's because certain ministries of the Holy Spirit are confused and not clearly delineated by individuals. So when we come to discuss the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we need to have a clear definition. And in studying this and looking at different resources, I thought Merrill Unger, who wrote a book entitled Baptism and Gifts of the Holy Spirit, wrote this back in the 1970s. Of all the resources I looked at, I liked his definition over the other ones I found. And so here's what Merrill Unger had to say, a well-known Bible teacher and writer. The baptism is that divine operation of God's Spirit which places the believer in Christ, in his mystical body, the church, and which makes him one with all other believers in Christ. The baptism makes the believer one in the life of the Son of God himself, sharing his common salvation, hope, and destiny. So, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is what occurs when we are placed into Christ and into the church. The Greek word for baptism means to dip or immerse. Now, there are at least 11 references to the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Scripture, and we're not going to look at all of them, of course, but I just want to kind of help you to understand that the first 5 references to the baptism of the Holy Spirit are all prophetic. That is, they're looking forward. So when you read Matthew 3:11, Mark 1:8, Luke 3:16, John 1:33, and Acts 1:5, when it talks about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's always forward. It says will happen or shall happen. It's something that is yet to occur, and therefore all of these references are prophetic. The first two, of course, is talking about the first three, rather. The first four, John the Baptist. And remember he said he baptized with water, but that there was one coming who would baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And even in Acts chapter 1 verse 5, Jesus is still talking about the baptism with the Spirit as a future event with the disciples there. Just before he ascends up into heaven, and he tells them to go to Jerusalem and to wait, and in 10 days the Holy Spirit would come and would baptize them. And that is in fact what took place. Now what is interesting is the reference in Acts 11:16. I ask you to turn there. We'll come back to 1 Corinthians 12:13, but Acts 11, Peter has returned to Jerusalem after having led Cornelius to faith in Christ, right, in Acts chapter 10, right? And you know that story, you're familiar with that story. God gave him a vision, and Cornelius had sent some men. The men came. They said, would you come back? And he went back because God had given him a vision. The Spirit had told him, go with those men. So when he got there, Cornelius said he had a vision that Peter would come and explain things to him. And so Peter preached the gospel to him. And before he even completed, the people got saved and they spoke in tongues. And so he makes his way back to Jerusalem, and the leaders of the church, so-called leaders of the church, were upset with him. Why? Because he had violated a Jewish practice of going into the home of a Gentile. So from their perspective, he had defiled himself and da-da-da-da-da, and they were upset. So Peter goes on to tell them exactly why he did what he did, because God gave him his vision, the Spirit of God said, go there. He went there and preached the gospel, and these people got saved. But start at verse 15. And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them as upon us when?
At the beginning.
That's a reference to the day of Pentecost. At the beginning. Then I remembered the words of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be. When the Lord said it, it was still future. That's why he's saying shall be, that's future tense, baptized with the Holy Spirit. Verse 17. If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, when did they get the gift? When they believed. Okay? Who was I that I could withstand God? So, he's confirming that what happened on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 was that when they were baptized with the Holy Spirit in Christ and in the church, that this is the exact same thing that happened with these Gentile believers in Acts chapter 10. And he's explaining, so I ran away too fast. Verse 18, when they heard these things, they became what?
Silent.
They stopped arguing. And they glorified God, saying, then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. And so, when he quotes the Lord there, he's quoting him before the event had taken place, because he said, I remember what the Lord had said. And that goes back to Acts 1:5, but the Spirit doesn't come to Acts chapter 2, verses 1 and 4. So Peter's referring to what took place on the day of Pentecost, when he and the apostles, the 120 and the 3,000, were baptized in, with, and by the Holy Spirit. And the reference that best explains all others is, and we can go back to 1 Corinthians 12:13. 1 Corinthians 12:13. And note what it says. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. The Spirit is the agent of the Lord Jesus Christ who baptizes believers. The Spirit baptizes all believers. For by one Spirit were some, most, the spiritual ones, the good-looking ones. No, all. And what makes this so interesting is, remember the church he's writing to. This is not the Philippians. This is not even the Thessalonians. This is the Corinthians, who he says in the earlier chapters, you're immature. You got all kind of sin going on in your church practice. But note, all of them were baptized baptized by the Spirit into the body. Not the spiritual ones, not the ones who were practicing what was right. All of them. Because it's not based on your practice. It's based on receiving Christ as your Savior. And the Spirit baptizes all believers into the body of Christ. Galatians 3. Here the emphasis is on being baptized in the body of Christ, but in Galatians 3:27 it says that we're baptized into Christ himself. So all believers are baptized into Christ, they're baptized into the body of Christ. So what happens? When a person believes in Jesus as Savior, he or she is placed into Christ and into his body, the church. Now, I'm going to give you about four or five things that we need to distinguish between the baptism of the Holy Spirit and what it is not. One, it is not the new birth. The baptism of the Spirit is not the new birth. That is a ministry of the Holy Spirit that takes place at the moment of salvation, but it is distinct from regeneration, while at the same time it takes place as regeneration. It is also not the indwelling of the Spirit. That's when the Spirit comes in and takes up residence with each individual believer. And again, that's at the moment of salvation. All of these things are done instantaneously and simultaneously. They're all non-experiential. That is, they're not the result of any experience that you and I have or do, but they come and then they result in the experiences that should follow, that are attested to in the New Testament for somebody who has a right relationship with God. It is not the sealing of the Spirit. We'll talk about that next week. The baptism, indwelling, regeneration, indwelling, baptism, and sealing all take place at the moment of salvation, are non-experiential, but they result in the experiences that demonstrate that God is in a person's life. It is not a second work of grace or a second blessing. This is the teaching of the Pentecostal slash charismatic movement, that somehow the baptism is something that is subsequent to salvation, and that it results in speaking in tongues, and that you gotta do something, and it's only for the sort of elite Christian. And of course, that's not true. And I'll just, one thing I'll show you. Look at, you're in 1 Corinthians 12, look at verse 30. Teresa, would you read that?
Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret?
And what's the expected answer?
No.
So, if speaking in tongues is a sign that you've been baptized with the Spirit, how would that work, since the scripture clearly says everybody don't speak in tongues? Okay? Everybody don't have that spiritual gift. Everybody doesn't do that. So that debunks that idea right now. Here's the problem. The problem is that the baptism of the Spirit is confused with the filling of the Spirit. That's the problem. And we're going to talk about the filling of the Spirit in a couple of weeks down the road. But that's the major reason why there's confusion. Because those two ministries of the Holy Spirit by Pentecostals, Charismatics, are seen to be the same thing. And they are not. All right? Again, if you go back and look at Acts 11, 16, as Peter's recounting what happened, he says, "Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us," what is he talking about? He's talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Okay? But when you go back to Acts chapter 2, in verses 1 to 4, this is what it says. "When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven and a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as fire, and one sat upon each of them." Verse 4. "And they were all" what?
Filled
with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." They were filled with the Spirit. What is not said about this event, and the only reason we know that it took place, was because of what Peter says in Acts chapter 17. Chapter 11. Not only were they filled with the Spirit, but prior to their being filled with the Spirit, they were baptized with the Spirit. Because on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit takes them and unites them to Christ, unites them to the body of Christ. It has to do with your position, not with your practice. And whether you're conscious of it or not, it took place the moment you believed. Just like regeneration, just like indwelling, and as we'll see next week, just like sealing. All of these things took place whether you were cognizant of them or not. The moment you said yes to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit gave you ribs. And it had nothing to do with your experiences. You had to work something up or drum something up or do something for this to take place. And again, the problem is that Pentecostal charismatic brothers, they confuse the baptism of the Spirit with the filling of the Spirit. And we'll talk about it later, but the filling of the Spirit is the endowment to enable us to have the power to accomplish God's will. The baptism of the Spirit is that which connects us to the Lord and to His body so that the subsequent ministries of the Holy Spirit, the ongoing ministries of the Holy Spirit, can be operational in the life of the one who walks in the Spirit and not in the flesh. And so these are all of these items that we're looking at in this acronym of RIBS. They're all non-repeatable, one-time events in the life of every believer. They all occur at the moment of salvation. And it's not contingent upon whether you're cognizant of it or not. Now here's the other point that you need to be clear on. There is no admonition or command to be baptized with the Spirit like there is to be filled with the Spirit. Nowhere in the Old Testament, nowhere in the New Testament are we told to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. There's no command, there's no admonition, because it occurs when an individual is saved. The baptism of the Holy Spirit deals with our position in Christ and connection to Christ. It is important to you and I because it is foundational to all the other ministries of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. In fact, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Charles Ryrie said in his book, The Holy Spirit, is foundational of fellowship, fruit bearing, strength for victory, and direction by the head of the body, the Lord Jesus Christ. The baptism of the Holy Spirit started this present dispensation of grace when it placed in those believers into this newly formed entity that God was now using called the Ecclesia, the church. Put Israel up on the shelf, and he's now using this new entity to accomplish his will in the world today. And so what God is still doing since the day of Pentecost is working through the church to accomplish His will in the world today. That's why each one of you who are believers are important. And while you may not make the 6 o'clock news, Jim Vance, Maureen Bunyan, whoever your favorite person is you watch on the 6 o'clock news, never gonna come and interview you. God is taking note of what you're doing, and God is directing you by His Spirit so that you accomplish what He intends, because you're the only people that can accomplish it. Those that are in the body of Christ, those that are believers, those that have been saved, those that have been baptized with the Spirit of God. And so it started the present dispensation of grace at Pentecost, and when the last person is baptized into the body of Christ, the church age will end and Jesus will come back for His church. Amen. That's why it's important. So what are some of the benefits to being baptized with the Holy Spirit? Let me give you a couple. We have a new union. We are united to all other believers. We have a new union. And therefore, according to Ephesians chapter 4, we need to endeavor to keep the unity of the faith. You see, because we're united one to another. There's a new unit. Before I got saved and before you got saved, Chris Nathan who? Why do I want to hang out with him on Sundays? For what? But see, now we're in a new union. And there's a unity that we are to endeavor to maintain. You see, the Holy Spirit creates the unity. We don't create the unity. I didn't create any unity between me and Chris. The Holy Spirit created that. But we have a responsibility to operate in the Spirit so that we maintain that unity that the Spirit created. But that's the result of being baptized with the Spirit. We have a new union. Not only do we have a new union, we have a new identification. We are now identified with Christ. We are now identified with the church. And we are no longer identified with the world. Therefore, the admonition in Romans 12:2, be not conformed to this world. Why? Because we don't identify with the world anymore. And we're no longer in Adam. Because being in Adam results in eternal death. But being in Christ results in eternal life. We have a new identification. We belong to Christ. And some people like to wear their identification. This is one of the reasons why I don't wear clerical garb. I don't have no collar turned around back. I don't wear a robe. I had a good friend of mine, he wore it because it said it saved on his suits. And so I said, that's fine. I understand that. That's fine. We wear to serve people. But listen, and a lot of people wear crosses to identify them, you know, and it's just amazing. And I'm not condemning all rappers, but you listen to some of them and they just cussing up a storm, but then they say, thank you, God. And I'm like, okay, well, how does that work? Okay. No, we're identified with Christ, and what demonstrates that we belong to him is the conduct and the conversation that we carry on in general. That doesn't mean that we don't ever get mad. It doesn't mean we don't ever slip up and say something we shouldn't say something. But again, it's the direction, not the perfection of it. It's the direction. And so we are identified with Christ because we can only talk and act like Christ because God's doing something on the inside. And he's not doing something on the inside of people that haven't been baptized with the Holy Spirit, who haven't been placed in Christ, who haven't been placed into Christ's body. And third, we have a new position. We are in the body of Christ, and I like this, forever. Forever. We are now in the position. Because we've been baptized with the Spirit, we're in the position to be justified, sanctified, delivered from the power of sin. We now have access to God. We gain an inheritance in Christ. And ultimately, we will be glorified. Because we have this new position. This new position is a challenge and an incentive to godly living. And it is the grounds of our victory over sin. So what is the baptism of the Spirit? Why is the baptism of the Spirit important to you? Well, here's another quote from Charles Ryrie. And he says, a lack of understanding of this doctrine obscures the important truth of our union with Christ, a consequence of which is a lack of any genuine basis for Christian living. It all deals with Christian living. All doctrinal truth that God gives is the foundation upon which we can live a godly life. If one does not understand the baptizing work of the Spirit, then he cannot or she cannot understand the one sure basis for holy living. The baptism joins us to Christ, and this is the basis for victory. So why is the baptism of the Spirit important to you? Because apart from the baptism of the Spirit, you would not be in Christ. You would not be in the church. And I'm not talking about the local visible church. I'm talking about the mystical body of Christ that all believers in this age are a part of. You would not belong to the Lord. You would be lost, unsaved, and headed to a Christless eternity in hell. But praise God, you have trusted Christ. And I trust that each one of you have trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. And when you did, You were baptized by, with, and in the Holy Spirit, and you belong to God for time and eternity. And now that you've been baptized with the Holy Spirit can work in your life. And what does he want to accomplish? He wants you to be a blessing. He wants to bless you, rather, and he wants you to make you a blessing in the life of other people. Thank God for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
So, it's worth reiterating again, but it is very important that you make a distinction in the various ministries of the Holy Spirit. Each one of these that formulate, that flesh out this acronym of RIBS are what the Holy Spirit does to every believer at the moment of salvation, so that these are all instantaneous and they are irreversible. You are regenerated, you are indwelt, and you are baptized with the Spirit. You're placed into Christ, placed into the body of Christ. And again, you must make the distinction between the filling of the Spirit and the baptism of the Spirit. The baptism is the foundation which enables you to be ready to receive all of the other ministries of the Holy Spirit in your life. And so, we ought to rejoice in the fact that God has given us ribs. And we'll finish the acronym next week. That's right. Father in heaven, thank you for the fact that we have been baptized with the Holy Spirit. Lord, we're now in Christ. Not only are we in Christ, but we're in the body of Christ. And we thank you that these things took place when we trusted Christ as our Lord and Savior. I pray that as a result of our having gained this clarification, this understanding, and knowing these biblical truths, that we will live lives that please you, that glorify you. Help us to be more like Christ in 2017. May our conduct and our conversation reflect the fact that you are forming Christ in us, and we are exhibiting and growing in the character of Christ. So bless us. May we go forth this week having been blessed and continuously being blessed by you throughout the week to be a blessing to others. And of course, the greatest blessing that we can bestow upon anyone is to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ with them. So I pray that we will do that and you will be glorified. Thank you for each one that's here. Continue to bless the families that have lost loved ones, and not only these two families, but others this last year who lost loved ones. We continue to lift them up in prayer as well, not forgetting that though time has passed from the time they lost their loved one, but that they're still in need of our prayer and of our encouragement. So Lord, be with each one, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place.
Amen. I trust you've been revived today. And it's all the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our life. Thank God that he sent his Spirit. But without the Spirit of God, where would we be? And we want to operate in his Spirit more and more so that we become more like Christ, and God gets more and more glory, and more people's lives are blessed because we have agreed with God. We operate under the authority of his Spirit as he leads us through his inspired word to live out a Christ-like life. Amen. Well, let's pray. Any concluding comment, question, thought?
I'd like to say something.
Yes.
I'd just like to say that maybe we could pray a little bit for the firefighters and that. My son was on a call, and he was saying how cold it was and the ice and everything. And, yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, we will pray. Father in heaven, we close the service with thanksgiving to you for giving to us your Holy Spirit. Thank you that we've been baptized in, by, and with the Holy Spirit, and that He's in our life. Lord, the request has come forth that we pray for the firefighters in this cold as they go out to execute their duties. We pray that you would keep them safe, and we pray that they would be able to put out the fires that they have to go to and help the people who are suffering as a result of the fires that take place. We also pray for all of the police officers and the work that they do in the community. Be with these men and women and keep them as they execute their jobs and do their work. We pray for those who are working the medical field also. Again, back up at Doctor's Hospital, so we pray for her and pray that you will heal her and restore her so that she could come home. Bless the medical personnel and all of the doctors and nurses who you have given wisdom and opportunity to practice so that they can help people who are hurting and in need. Bless us as we return to our homes. Give us safety on the road. Thank you that we were safe in coming here today. And we just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Amen.